Good to see everyone back tonight. We're so glad that you're here with us. It's a pleasure to have you here on this Sunday evening as we come together to worship the God of heaven in spirit and in truth. If you have any comments or you have any questions about anything you hear tonight, anything that you see, please let us know. When this lesson's over with, I'll be in the back. Feel free to ask any questions you might have or make a comment regarding anything you hear. That's no problem whatsoever. We would encourage that. We would ask that you prove everything that is said this evening, that you get your Bibles out and you make sure that the things that are spoken in this lesson are so. As we always say, if I don't preach what the Bible teaches, I shouldn't be up here, and neither should any other preacher. 1 Peter 4, verse 11, they ought to be preaching only the oracles of God. So please follow along with me. We're in the book of Hebrews tonight, so if you open your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, we can go ahead and begin in chapter 1 because we're going to do a review tonight. We'll be in chapter 10 and verse 36. We're only going to cover one verse because by the time that I got this outline done, I had a bunch on this one verse, and I figured that it would go ahead and take up the whole time. So we're going to look at chapter 1, if you will, and let's make some points in this review. We go through this review every Sunday night. We did this with the book of Romans, and what we learned in the book of Romans is everybody in here knew what every chapter was about. And I think that's a tremendous benefit whenever you are interacting with other folks. Some of our friends will say, hey, well, Romans 4 is about, Paul is saying that it has nothing to do with obedience, it's faith only. Nope. You missed it. That's not what it's about at all. And anybody in here can answer that because we went over it in great detail. Now, we're doing the same thing in the book of Hebrews. And what we're learning is we're learning a tremendous amount about this book. We're learning a tremendous amount about the inspired letter that was written to these Christians. They were written to Christians. But these Christians were of a Judaizing background. They came out of Judaism into Christianity. So the background was the law of Moses, and they were actually in jeopardy, in danger of going back into the law. So you have an inspired epistle written to these individuals, encouraging them not to go back into the old, not to go back into the inferior, but to stay with the superior, to stay with the new. And so it's a tremendous, tremendous study so far, and it's been very worthwhile to all of us who've been here. Chapter 1. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath born heir of all things, and by whom also he made the world, so being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he hath by himself purged our sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Now chapter 1, we say, is a threefold contrast of Jesus Christ. He begins this epistle to these Christians who were in danger of going back into the old, and he shows them the superiority of Jesus threefold. Verses 1 and 2, Jesus is superior to the prophets of old. Verses 3 through 9 and 13 and 14, Jesus Christ is superior to angelic beings. And chapter 1, verses 10 through 12, Jesus Christ is superior to even his own creation. So, he begins this argument, which is what he sets forth. The book of Hebrews is a book of contrast. And he sets forth in the very first chapter to establish one important principle. Jesus is superior to any other. Chapter 2, first four verses. Therefore, we ought to give a more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels, what's that? Let's stop for a second. Go back to chapter 1, verse 13. Where it says, for which of the angels saith he at any time, sit thou my right hand till I make thy enemies thy footstool. Right hand is a position of authority. So he would go on in chapter 2 and say, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels, chapter 1, if the word spoken by angels who are inferior, when God came down upon Sinai in Exodus chapter 18, an angelic being or angels went from the hand of God and carried that stone to Moses. God apparently didn't literally hand it to Moses, but it was given via the disposition of these angels. And it was said in such a way in this text as that it was spoken by them. So you have the angelic beings, their word was steadfast. The law of Moses is definitely what it's referencing. The law of Moses was steadfast, was it not? In Numbers 14, when the children of Israel rebelled against the true report of the two spies, they rebelled against this. Was there a consequence to it? Oh, there was, wasn't there? Was there a consequence when man failed to keep the law of Moses? Was there a consequence for violating the Sabbath day? Was there a consequence for blaspheming God? There was, wasn't there? if the law or the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense and reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Notice the contrast. The word spoken by angels contrasted to this great salvation, which at the beginning was spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also bearing the witness both of signs and wonders and divers miracles, gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. Hebrews 2:1-4. Contrast, first four verses. We must obey Jesus or else. Now beginning in verse 5. Verses 5 through 8, he takes you back quoting David, speaking of man in God's plan. In verse 9, he says, but now we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels. Well, he just said that in verse 6, didn't he? He said that in verses 6 or 7. He said that about man. Man was made lower than the angels. And he says it about Jesus. But now we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels. Why? For the suffering of death, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Why was Jesus made man? Why did the pre-incarnate Word, why did the eternal Word of God, why did the second person of the Godhead, why did he come to earth? Why was he clothed in flesh? So that he could live and die for us. That's why. So in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, he establishes that we must obey Jesus or else. And now, beginning in verse 5, all the way through the end of the chapter, he tells you why. Why must you obey Jesus? Because he is superior, because of his role as Redeemer. Now, that's something that's kind of a nuance that a lot of people perhaps don't understand from this book. This book emphasizes Jesus' superiority because of his work as man, not necessarily his eternal nature, not necessarily his deity. Now, that's very important also. We know from Hebrews 7:24 that it would require an eternal man to make reconciliation for our sins and to be our high priest, not just any man would do. We know that. We're not taking away from his deity, but what I'm saying is what is emphasized in this book is his manhood, the fact that he was a person, he was a human, his humanity, his role as a human being in the role of redemption, which required him to come and live as a man and die as a man. That is what is emphasized greater than anything else in this book. Chapter 3. Contrast. First four or five verses. Verse 5. But Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of these things which were to be spoken after. He was faithful as what now? As a servant. Verse 6, three-letter word begins that verse. But Christ as a son. Is there a difference between a son and a servant? Luke 15, remember the prodigal son? He says, I will come back and let me be as thy servant. So there's a difference between a son and a servant. And there's a difference between the Son of God and any other man to come before. So Moses specifically in the first six verses is being contrasted. Moses, he was a great lawgiver under the law of Moses. He was mediator between God and man. He was faithful. He was meek. But Moses wasn't Jesus. What a difference. He was a servant under the house. Jesus is a son over a house. Now beginning in verse 7 all the way through the end of the chapter, he gives you the consequence of disobeying Moses, who was, you ready? Inferior. The consequence of disobeying the inferior was you won't enter the land of Canaan. The consequence of disobeying Jesus is you won't get to heaven. First three chapters. Right? Chapter 4. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, and if you should sin to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith, and then that heard it. Chapter 4 is about the fourth commandment, the Sabbath, given to the nation of Israel and only to the nation of Israel, Deuteronomy chapter 5, 13 through 15, not to you, not to me, not to Abraham, not to Isaac, not to Adam, given only to the nation of Israel upon their release from Egyptian bondage, Exodus 12, that's when it was given, in chapter 16, that's when it was given to them, because he released them from bondage. But it's talking about rest. Chapter 4 is about rest. Rest wasn't actually realized under the law of Moses. Yes, they observed the Sabbath every week, didn't they? They observed it every 7 years. And they observed it every 49 years. Every Jubilee they observed it. However, that observation of it wasn't the fulfillment of it. It was foreshadowing something greater. In Colossians 2 and verse 17, it says, let therefore no man judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or the new moon or of the Sabbath, which were a shadow of things to come, but the substance, the body casting the shadow, is of Christ. These were shadows meant to teach. And Hebrews 4 tells you that. rest from sin was not realized under the law of Moses. Rest from sin was realized under Christ. Matthew 11, beginning in verse 28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you, you know this verse, rest. What would Christ give them? Where? In Christ. In Christ, they would have rest from their sins. Paul would say in Acts 13, verse 39, that through him, Christ, you're justified from all things which you could not be by the law of Moses. It wouldn't justify them from these things. The law of Moses was never meant to be a system of pardon. The law of Moses was always intended to do two things. Teach and prepare. That was the point of the law of Moses. Galatians 3:24. It was not meant to redeem. Chapter 5 compares the priesthood of men to the priesthood of Jesus. In the first about four verses. The priesthood of Jesus and the priesthood of men under the law of Moses was only given by divine mandate. In other words, the Levites, who were priests under the law of Moses, just as Christ, who would be a priest under a new covenant, they were both given by divine decree. Only by the authority of God were they made priests. And he's going to tell them more about that in chapter 6 and chapter 7. But he's going to take a moment, he's going to offer a little rebuke at the end of chapter 5, telling them that they need strong meat instead of this milk. It says that those folks who use milk are unskillful in the word of righteousness for their babes. Strong meat belongeth unto them who are of full age, who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Chapter 6. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, maturation. Let us go on unto maturity, leaving elementary principles. How are we going to teach our children? How are we going to be effective teachers, preachers, Christians, Bible study teachers? How are we going to have Bible studies with other folks who are in denominational churches or who have never understood the truth, never heard of the actual teachings of the gospel? How are we going to go to these folks who are in error? How are we going to go to them and teach them the truth if we ourselves don't know it? If we can't move beyond the elementary principles of repentance, of baptism, of the understanding of a judgment day, of an understanding of the resurrection, if we can't move beyond elementary principles and teach some strong meat, how are we going to be effective? They weren't going to be, and you won't be either. We've got to mature. We've got to move beyond. That doesn't mean you leave them behind. It means you move beyond them in knowledge so that you're able to reasonably present it to others. Chapter 6, the latter half of that chapter, the consequence of growth is you learn more and more to trust in God. And Abraham is used as an example. Chapter 7. A superior priesthood. Was it Levitical? Was it? Verse 11. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it been received the law, what further need was there for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed, there is made a necessity a change also of the law. For he of whom these things speaketh pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood. Jesus Christ could not be priest under the law. Oh, Jesus could do anything he wanted to. Jesus Christ could not be priest under the law of Moses. Nope. You know why? Because he wasn't the right tribe. The only ones authorized to be a priest under the law of Moses were the sons of Levi, Gershon, Merari, and Kohath. That was the three. He wasn't part of that, therefore he couldn't be priest. So you know what God did? Because God knew he was going to have his son, the eternal priest, over an eternal kingdom, he was going to change the law because he made a change to the priesthood. Chapter 7 comes before chapter 8, doesn't it? You know what chapter 8 is about? A changed and a superior covenant. Which one came first? Which one came first as far as our purpose is concerned? God was going to change the priesthood, therefore he was going to change the law. And he did, didn't he? Chapter 8, great deal of that quotes four verses from Jeremiah 31, beginning in verse 31 all the way through verse 34. He quotes it verbatim, speaking of a new covenant, not one according to the law of Moses, which he did when he took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. This is going to be a new covenant. It was going to be a covenant in which if you entered into this relationship, you were already taught of God, John 6, 44 and 45. You weren't born into it physically, then you were taught. You were taught, then you were born into it spiritually. John 3, 3 through 5. Chapter 8, superior priesthood. Chapter 9, a superior tabernacle with superior service. He goes and he reflects back on the tabernacle in the first several verses. He sees the holy place. He sees the most holy place. He sees the instruments used. So we have a contrast of Jesus being a superior offering, as we'll see further in chapter 10. This is going to be a superior tabernacle. The church of Christ is superior to the tabernacle of Moses. It is the reflection. It is what was foreshadowed by this tabernacle. And the service of the priests then were inferior to and foreshadows of our service now in the kingdom. 1 Peter 2 and verse 9. But even greater than our service is his service, being a minister of the tabernacle, the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched and not man. Chapter 10. Six times the word offering is used in the book of Hebrews, all six of them in this chapter. The overwhelming understanding or point of this chapter is a superior offering. Jesus Christ is the superior offering. He begins by saying that the law of Moses was a shadow of things to come. It was not the very image or substance of those things. There was an understanding that those sacrifices were not meant to forgive sins. They were meant to foreshadow something greater, verses 3 and 4. And you can see that something greater in verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. Verses 6 and 8, he reflects back on the inferior sacrifices and said he came to do the will of God. Same thing in verses 7 and 9. Verse 10, these priests would stand daily offering and ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices which could not take away sins. But this man, when he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, guess what he did? He didn't stand daily. You know what he did? He sat down. Contrast. He would go on to say, for he hath by one sacrifice perfected forever them that are sanctified. Verse 15, the Holy Ghost is a witness to these things, isn't he? How did the Holy Spirit witness to them? By the inspired teachings of Jeremiah. Reference Jeremiah 31 through 34. And that's how he bears witness today. The Holy Spirit does not bear witness with you in some direct way. No, he does not. The Holy Spirit bears witness with you through his inspired word. John 6, 63. Romans 8 and verse 16. He would go on to say, now where remission of these is. Remission of sins. There's no more sacrifice. Then he speaks about the next verse of having boldness to enter into the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God. Then he speaks of drawing near with a pure heart and the full assurance of faith. Speak about having our bodies washed with pure water. That's a reference to obedience to the gospel. He would go on to verse 24 to speak of, let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. Verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as a manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. What happens if we fail to neglect, or we fail to consider one another? Verse 24, we fail to provoke one another to good things by assembling. Verse 25, what's the result? Verse 26, willful sin. Verse 27, a fearful looking for of judgment and firing indignation. Verse 28, those that despise Moses' law. Isn't that interesting? It says they despised it by not keeping it. How much more so by those of us who are members of the body of Christ and we don't even make efforts to assemble together? We don't love each other enough to provoke one another in the assemblies? They said they despised Moses' law. Do you think that God thinks you despise his law by not even bothering to show up? He would go on to speak of the fearful thing, verse 31, of falling into the hands of the living God. He would exhort them to have patience, knowing that we're about to face some difficulties, and that is, of course, where we find ourselves tonight. For ye have need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. For, let's look at verses 34 and 35. For you had compassion on me on my bonds, and you took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that you have a better and an enduring substance, and that, of course, is in heaven. And he would say, cast not away, therefore, the confidence which hath a great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience. Patience means endurance. In this text, patience means endurance, especially as we find ourselves in the context of 34, 35, and then these next few verses. Some of these next few verses, as a matter of fact, verse 37 is going to throw a lot of people off. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Oh, that means the Lord returns. No, it's not. He's talking about. He's talking about returning in such a way, returning in a manner to alleviate the persecution they were facing. And that would come one of two ways. Their lives would end, or some of them would endure beyond the persecution that they suffered. One or the other. This isn't talking about an actual return of the Lord. So understanding verse 27, and of course verse 27 is a quote from Habakkuk chapter 2. So knowing that this is a quote, we understand in Habakkuk chapter 2, he was speaking about the certainness of his judgment. And that's how verse 37 needs to be understood. And that's how this verse needs to be understood. Understanding the certainness of God's promise, we have to endure difficulties. The need here is for continued enduring faithfulness, especially during difficult times. In 2 Timothy 4, beginning in verse 5, it says, "But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished the course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." This speaks of an enduring faithfulness. Paul's last letter he would ever write, the last opportunity he would get to speak to his son in the faith, Timothy, and he would tell him that he must endure. 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning verse 10. "But thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me in Antioch, and Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured. But out of them the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." You know, sometimes there's going to be some persecution for doing right. Remember this morning we talked about that just a little bit? To some degree. In Luke 6:26 it says, "Beware when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets before them." Luke 16 verse 15. "What man is esteemed highly is abominable in the sight of God." It's interesting, isn't it? If you do right, you're going to be persecuted. It's just the way that it's going to be. You're going to be persecuted for doing right. What if you compromise? Well, you'll probably be okay, won't you? You'll be okay physically, but not spiritually. We must stand for truth. And if you stand for truth by nature, you're going to be divisive, because truth is divisive. Not contentious, not arrogant, not haughty, but divisive just because truth is. Alright? So that after you've done the will of God, you need patience. You need endurance. Because after you've done the will of God, obviously, initial obedience to the gospel is necessary, isn't it? Of course, because you have to first be a Christian, and he's writing to Christians. So you can see that in Acts 2:38, 22:16 and all. But what is being spoken of here is continued faithfulness during difficult times. We already showed you 2 Timothy 4, 5, but just again, he warns him, he admonishes him to endure afflictions. In Hebrews 10, the same chapter, just a few verses prior, he says, "But call to remembrance the former days, in which after you were illuminated, you endured." Notice that word, fight. Struggle, contention. A great fight of afflictions. Not only did they suffer for their own, but they actually were partakers of others because of the support of the faithful who were being persecuted by others. They endured it. We even spent a little time on that word, that phrase, "you endure," as opposed to "you compromise," "you fail," "you failed." Rather, it's "you endured," and that's important. During these difficulties, Christians are expected to be faithful. Christians are expected to overcome. Does God expect that of us? Yes, he does. Does God expect something of you that you're not capable of doing? And God said, "Be thou faithful unto death," even unto death. Revelation 2 and verse 10, we'll see that in just a moment. Even if it costs you your life, even at the pain of death, you will be faithful to me, he says. And if you do. Isn't that what we talked about in 1 Peter chapter 1 this morning as we're doing the Bible study? Verses 6 through 8, Peter prepares them for the difficulties that they're going to face. It's manifold temptations, but it's temporary. And he tells them in verse 4, and he tells them in verse 5, and he tells them in verse 9 of the blessings that will follow if only they endure. Does the New Testament have anything? Does that have much to say on this concept? It's full of it. It is completely full of this concept of enduring, especially during difficult times. Matter of fact, the book of Revelation, that is the overall point of it. The book of Revelation explains to a Christian how to die in Christ, even amid persecutions. The epistles are written to tell you what? how to live in Christ. The book of Revelation was written to tell you how to die in Christ, how to die faithfully. During these difficulties, Christians are expected to be faithful, and Christians are expected to overcome. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. What happens if they're not faithful unto death, and you don't get a crown of life? Faithfulness. Faithfulness in difficulties. Now, we talked about that this morning, again, on the Bible class. It's very likely that we're not going to have someone with a gladius to the throat of our son or our daughters or our family member and saying, you renounce Christ or I'm going to remove his head. They did that then. You renounce Christ or I'm burning you at the stake. You renounce Christ or I'm going to cover you with meat and I'm going to throw you to the lions. You renounce Christ or else we're going to do these terrible things for you. Well, Jesus said, you can't renounce me. Don't do that. Even if it costs you your life, don't do it. And a lot of folks died faithfully. I'm sure there were a lot that didn't. And they lived to regret it. A constant theme in Scripture is tribulations that the faithful will face. Why could it be such a steadfast? 1 Peter 1:23, the word of the Lord endures forever, doesn't it? Why is it such a steadfast theme under any circumstance, in any society, in any millennium, in any century? If you live faithfully, you will suffer to some degree for it. Why is that a constant thing? Interesting, isn't it? Is this only for the first century Christians? Can we not suffer to some degree today? Can we be ostracized? Can we be called bigots and haters of people because we stand for truth? I promise you right now, I don't hate anyone. Nobody. Now, I hate every false way, Psalm 119, verse 104 and 105, but I don't hate a human being. I might hate sin and what they're engaging in, but I'd be glad to tell them about it. And only because God says it's wrong, not because I think it's wrong. I'm not the standard, am I? But if you are standing for truth, you're going to be different. You're going to be standing apart. You know that Jesus Christ, why did they crucify him? He was the most controversial figure ever to walk the earth. Did you know that? Oh, no, Jesus was a uniter. Jesus was a divider. Jesus divided people. He even said he came to bring division. It wasn't that he wanted division, but what it was is he came to reveal truth, and truth will divide folks. It's going to make mama and daddy argue. It's going to bring your brother and sister against each other. Why? Because somebody's standing for truth and somebody isn't. In 1 Corinthians 11, verse 19, it speaks about division. That these things will actually be necessary because some folks are going to stand for truth and others won't. It isn't that division is necessarily approved. That's not what we're talking about. But we're saying sometimes it's just going to happen because some folks are going to stand and others aren't. And when that happens, there's going to be division. When we stand for the truth on certain matters, there's going to be division. It's going to be that way, and it will always be that way. But the good thing about it is even during these difficulties, that if we remain steadfast, if we remain faithful, we are going to have a wonderful, eternal reward. In Romans 8, beginning in verse 35, it says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As is written, for thy sake we are accounted as sheep for the slaughter." We're killed all the day long, he say. We're accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Nothing can separate us from God. You know what can separate you from God? You. You can separate you from God. Nothing else. Oh, my spouse. Oh, well, my spouse is not a New Testament Christian. My spouse is, you know, he's really or she's really giving me a hard time about this. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 speaks about, man, you don't have to follow your spouse away from the Lord. If they want to go, let them go. You serve the Lord. Now, that doesn't give you the right to remarry, by the way. That's what not under bondage means. It means you're not under bondage to follow him away from your first love. You can't do that. Let them go if that's what they want. That's not that's a great thing. No, it's not at all. But some folks, you can't change their minds. If they're going to go, they're going to go. Oh, well, something else as well. The government, they're going to persecute us if we speak up against the truth. So what? Are you so afraid of this physical consequences that you're going to forfeit your soul forever? Oh, I'll repent later. Will you? You know what repentance is? It's an actual genuine change of will. I wonder if under that gladius with that Roman sword to my throat, if I was living back then, and they said, renounce Christ or die. And I wonder if I did renounce him. I wonder if I could even repent. Thinking about that. My life would be over at that moment. I renounced the one that died for me. Can you imagine the sorrow you would feel for that? How terrible guilty you would feel for that? A constant theme in Scripture. The righteous are going to suffer because they are doing right. 1 Peter 2, beginning verse 19. For this is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. Wait a minute. Now this is a whole new ballgame. Now if I do something wrong, okay, I'll go ahead and take it like a man. I'll take it on the chin, so to speak. But if I didn't do anything wrong, I'm going to set you straight. Is that what you're supposed to do? To set you straight? Oh, I'll get the last word. Why? What if you suffer wrongfully? Just take it. Oh, well, he did me this way, and I'm suffering for it. I'm gonna set me. I need vengeance. No, you don't. You need to just take it. For what good is it? What glory is it if when you're buffeted for your own faults, you shall take it patiently? But if when you do well and suffer for it and take it patiently, this is acceptable. I didn't do anything wrong, yet I'm suffering for it. That's fine. You know what they did in the book of Acts? They rejoiced. Having been worthy to suffer shame in the name of their Savior. They were beaten. Why? For preaching the truth. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. He would say in the next chapter that he is an individual who didn't do any sin. He was just. And yet he still suffered. Okay? That you might receive the promise. What is the promise? There's a lot of promises in Scripture. There's a lot of promises. The promise of Acts 2:38 is not this promise. I believe the promise of Acts 2:38 is something entirely different. But this is a promise. It's a contextual promise. It's a promise in the context. Look, at verse 34, it speaks of in heaven a better and an enduring promise or substance. In verse 39, it speaks of a recompense or reward, which could be understood in the same line as verse 34. It speaks of our reward, which is coming in heaven. All right, so let's notice this one. Revelation 14:13. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. When you understand the book of Revelation, understand that as the entire theme. That is the background. That is the core. Dying saved. Regardless of whether you understand it pre-AD 70, regardless of whether you understand it as Vespasian's rule, regardless of whether you understand it under Domitian at the end of the first century, it doesn't matter. What matters is the theme is always the same. Dying saved. Now in the very same book, notice this, Hebrews 9:15, and for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise of an eternal inheritance. What's that promise? Hebrews 10:21-23. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful to promise. What did he promise? Same promise of the verse we're looking at. Those who remain faithful during tribulations and trials will receive that promise. That promise being redemption in Christ. Ephesians 3 and verse 6. If you die, Revelation 14:13, in Christ, you're going to receive that blessing. But in order to die in Christ, you have to be faithful in this life, even during difficulties. I'd like to extend an invitation to this. Are there any here tonight that have never obeyed the gospel? What if you recognize that you've never heard that phrase before, or you're not sure what that means? The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 1, verses 8 and 9, for those who don't obey the gospel, their fate is going to be everlasting destruction. So I'd ask the question, have you obeyed the gospel? Well, no, I haven't. What must I do? Romans chapter 10 and verse 8 says, this word, this gospel, the New Testament is the word of faith. Verse 17, it says, faith comes by hearing the word of God. Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, without faith it is impossible to please God. So we must have faith. We must hear the word of God and we must believe it. John 17 and verse 21, Jesus prayed and he would say that we would be able to believe on him through the inspired letters and the inspired writings of those who would follow him, the apostles. We could believe on him through their writings. Their writings would say that we must repent of our sins. Matthew 21, 28, 29 speaks of a man who told his son to go work in the vineyard. And he says, I will not, but later he repented and went. What did he do? He changed his mind. He changed his will, and then his actions changed. Repentance is a change in will, and it leads to changed actions. If you don't change your actions, you've not really changed your will. And repentance is commanded to all men everywhere. Acts 17, 30. You must confess Christ before men. Romans 10, 10. Confession is made with the mouth, and it goes toward salvation. You must be baptized for the remission of sins. Baptism is for the remission of sins. It is in the name of the resurrected Christ, Acts 2:38, Acts 22:16. It is why his blood was shed, Matthew 26:28. It's when we contact his blood, Acts 22:16, Revelation 1:5. It's when we're made alive from the dead, Colossians 2:11-13. And it's when we're made the children of God by faith, Galatians 3:26-27. It's when we're buried with Christ in baptism, Romans 6:3-4. And it's when we're closely united with him, Romans 6:5. It's when we are made free from our obedience from the heart to that gospel, Romans 6, 16 through 18. Yes, it is necessary. Yes, it is a commandment of God. And no, it's not Holy Spirit baptism. It's baptism in water, and it's for the remission of sins. Ephesians 4, 4 and 5. There's only one baptism, and that's it. And you must remain faithful all your life, walking in the light of his word. If you do, we have hope, even during difficult times. For those who have obeyed the gospel, what if you're not faithful? What if you recognize that you're not faithful? What if you've erred from the truth? What if you fall from your steadfastness? 2 Peter 3:18. Repent. Change your mind about that. Acknowledge those things as sinful to the Lord, and he will forgive you. If you need the prayers of the church, we'll offer them on your behalf. We're going to sing an invitation song. As we do, consider the words of the song. If anyone wants to study further, if anyone wants to obey the gospel, come down here at the front. We'll study with you. We'll make sure you know exactly what you're doing, and everything will be proven in the scripture. We'll baptize you into Christ, and you can leave here white as snow. Isaiah 1:18. For those who need to come back to the Lord, come down, and we'll offer prayers on your behalf. The invitation is yours. Please come now as we stand.
Who at the door is standing?